Our viewers at home, this is an exclusive interview with the former First Lady of South Africa, Thobeka Madiba Zuma, who will be taking us through her life journey and where she is now since leaving the presidency and, of course, no longer being a First Lady. But that doesn't mean that she doesn't have a role to play in our society. And one of the things she will be talking us through is her newly formed foundation named after her. Former First Lady, thank you so much for your time and thank you for allowing Newsroom Africa into your space today. It's almost been a year, it's more than a year actually, since you've left Mahlamba Lovu and of course exiting your role as First Lady. But I think there's often a perception about what a First Lady is. Some people think you're just there to look pretty. Some people think you're just there to be an aide to the president. But in actual fact, you play a more crucial role. Let's just step back a bit and tell us what it was like being First Lady. What kind of duties were you expected to execute in that particular role?
I think the duties were made up of the official duties where you need to travel accompanying the head of state. But apart from that, it would translate to ensuring that you have got programs of your own that you pick and choose depending what your appetite is and implementing them. But the primary one was that of the official duties as a spouse of the president. And then the secondary one, as I said, would entail ensuring that you've got programs. Like myself, I chose health because I was informed by the very fact that, you know, health is at the center of everything. The economy of this country will not grow if the health implementation or rollout is not sound. And that what informed me to say, you know, as much as I've got the financial background, you know, education, but, you know, health, if the population of our country is not healthy, then they wouldn't be contributing meaningfully to drive the growth of the economy of our country. So I think that sums up what the role of the First Lady is and was for me.
And now if you look at your life after, you know, your husband left the presidency and your contribution towards society. I mean, I've just already mentioned that you've started up the Thobeka Madiba Zuma Foundation. What led you to do that and for you to actually say, you know what, I'm still going to continue with my cause. I'm still going to continue forging ahead with this despite perhaps maybe not having the resources. I mean, what has it taken? What are the fundamental differences now as a, in your ability to do your job as it was perhaps then?
Okay. I think for me to take a step back, Zianda, back then in 2010, that's when the foundation was actually conceptualized and started operating. And the reason why I started back then, it was informed by the very reason that I know that at some point, you know, the term in the presidency of my husband being the head of state would come to an end. And for me, it was continuity that was important. And what also was more important for me was that whatever that I was doing, it wasn't temporary. You know, I was doing something that I was passionate about, which is ensuring that, you know, champion or pioneer the health matters that concern women and our girl children. And that's what informed me to start the foundation, the Thobeka Madiba Zuma Foundation. And even then, there aren't any fundamental differences between now and then, because even then, I didn't enjoy any, not much of the resources from the state to run my foundation. It was self-sustainable and not dependent. And I think for me, what I was careful about, not to create any dependency whatsoever in the presidency. And it helped me a great deal because the transition between now and then, or then and now, is not huge. I was always depending on the foundation to roll out the programs, but working very closely with the Department of Health as well as the presidency.
And is it still the same kind of rapport to get people to come and assist you, to come on board with your programs, whether it's the events that you host, and we'll get to the event that you're hosting. I'm sure a lot of people will be asking, you know, is it still the same?
I think I'm still enjoying the same support, I'd call it support, and access. when I talk about access, I'm talking about the speed dial to the, either the MSC in the province, to either, you know, the Department of Health at a national level. It's still the same for me. And it was more even then to say, I'll continue to support the government of the day, regardless of who's occupying, you know, the presidency, whether it's still my husband or now currently the sitting president. I think our government is still enjoying the same support. And the only difference that I would really now say I'm feeling is that I've got more time, because the primary responsibilities then were more on the spousal duties vis-a-vis the foundation. So the focus, all my energy now is directed towards running the foundation, ensuring that we roll out the amazing programs that we have in an impactful way, and our focus is more on the rural areas. So I get more time now to travel and to also, you know, all the energy, as I said, it's just towards the foundation, nothing more towards the state anymore. I think that's the fundamental difference for me.
So one of the interesting things about you is that out of all the first ladies at the time, former first ladies, you lived your life pretty much more publicly, I would say, than any of the other former first ladies. Do you think that that put you in good stead to really, you know, to change the face of that particular role in society, being first lady, but also to say that first ladies too can contribute? I mean, if you look at Michelle Obama, mm-hmm. she completely changed the entire way in which we looked at that particular role. I mean, some would say you've had some bad moments on social media, but was there what would you say was the good?
I think for me, what informed me is being accessible to the people. And being informed by the saying in Zulu, which goes "Umuntu umuntu ngabantu," and if you're accessible and people can reach out to you, that's the most important thing. People need to feel connected. And especially for me, the youth, is we are more attracted because they are our future. And if we invest our time and our energy towards ensuring that the issues that affect our youth, whether socially or otherwise, are taken care of, and people know that they have a voice, those they cannot speak for themselves, and they've got more an ambassador. Because, I mean, for me, what I enjoyed the most then is that I didn't have to make an appointment, you know, with the president. And it could be during breakfast, and I've said this so many times that, you know, the advantage I would not make an appointment, you know, to talk about, do you know that cervical cancer is undermining the work that is being done by our government within the area of HIV/AIDS, and those need to be looked at holistically and under one umbrella. You can't divide a woman. You've got to look at a woman completely. Say, yes. I can't say, Zianda, I'm not going to look at your HIV status, but not check your cervix. Because if I look at your HIV status only and not look at your cervix, you might die from the cervix while I've given you ARVs and everything. So I would say the issues that affected our women, it's something that for me helped me to say, let me be their voice. As much as it doesn't necessarily mean that the government wasn't worried about, you know, those issues, but if a person constantly, say, Minister of Health, the bread has got so much salt, when is the government being the establishment that has got the legal leg to force the industry that produces bread, and bread is breakfast, lunch and supper for a person who is poor in the rural areas, but yet it undermines their health when it comes to whether they have hypertension, it contributes in a negative way. So I think for me, yeah, those are the things I think right now. And a platform also, Zianda, with something that I'm really grateful for, to impact our society in a bigger scale than I would have while I was still working in the private sector. We still have those CSIs, you know, within the companies that I worked for, and we'd go out there, winter on the campaign, take a girl child to work. We started those. But when I then occupied this position, which I don't, because it doesn't have executive powers, but it's a position of influence. That's how I refer to it. Influence in society, influencing policy in a strategic, you know, way, and also meaningful way to say, let us put women up there on the agenda.
What do you think are some of the successes then, when you were in that position, and the things that you still need to do through the use of your foundation? You did say this was conceptualized in 2010. You had access to the president. What are some of the things that you can say, I'm really proud that in this position, positionality is a very important aspect. He says, I'm very proud that when I was still the First Lady, I was able to achieve this and this. Not because I'm First Lady, but through, you know, my belief and this position of influence that you speak of through your foundation.
I think, Zianda, there are two that I'd like to mention for me that stand out as we speak. One of them here in our country was we'd been lobbying our Minister of Health, who was faced with competing priorities, Minister Motsoaledi back then, with competing priorities in terms of who do I save, what do I do? There is so much to be done. There was a lot to be done. And we advocated for our girl children to be vaccinated against the human papillomavirus. It's called HPV in short, and that puts them in a safer position to get cervical cancer. And, you know, I think that's what makes me sleep peacefully at night, knowing that in the public schools, that program is up and running and the numbers are just growing. And I think it started back then in my time when we said we need our girl children to be vaccinated. We need them to be vaccinated, to be protected. At least we would be, we'd find comfort in knowing that, you know, this disease is not going to wipe them out. And the second one at an, I would say, continental level or regional level was when I was chosen to be the chairperson of the Forum of African First Ladies Against Breast and Cervical Cancer, where there's a lot of work that we did with the global partners to move the agenda forward and really compelling, not really, maybe compelling is not the perfect word, but really to say, can the heads of state stop, reflect, and focus on the non-communicable diseases? And we achieved that because in New York, during the NGA, that's when there was a point in time where the heads of state that just focused on the non-communicable diseases. And the non-communicable diseases had just sort of like taken a back seat, and yet they were on the rise. And even when you worked them out and calculated them, you would find that they would eat up a lot of the budget in our different countries, but yet they weren't getting the attention which they deserve.
We can't just only talk about the good. What are some of the bad aspects of having lived that life, that maybe as a woman, we're talking about women and the different roles that women play in society, some of the tough moments that you went through as First Lady that you think maybe at some stage made you even forget about all the good things that you were doing, the work that you put in, the accolades that you received, and you thought, this is low. I'm not sure if I want to live this life anymore.
I wouldn't really say, you know, I looked at them as such. There were challenges, you know. Life is about challenges. Life is about, I think it's the demands that come with being in that position, to try and strike the balance between the family, your kids, to try and keep them out of the public eye, yes, and to try and also show, bring some normality to your household, the pressures that it came with at home, I mean at school. Your child at the age of 5, 6 has to conceptualize and try and understand that, you know what, okay, your dad is the president of the country. Mommy, what is the president of the country? What is daddy's job? Is it to speak, you know? I think for me is to try and create a wall between the outside world and your family and protect your kids, to try and keep normality. And also whatever that's happening outside there that's negative, not to affect them in a big way, the impact, to try and minimize the impact. I would say for me, those have been the challenging times, as you would, you know, remember that there were times where it really got tough. And as a mother, you try and be like a chicken. You want to protect your kids and ensure that they're protected at all costs.
Did it work?
I think it did for me, because it's kept my kids very grounded, and being able to differentiate, and put whatever challenges that were out there at arm's length and don't let them affect them. It made them stronger too. What I've noticed is that they're stronger. You know, my daughter would, yeah, is very strong. If a child talks, say something at school that's negative, say, could you repeat that again? You know? I was shocked when she told me. I was like, okay, let's stop it at that. You don't take it further than that.
It's very interesting because I think what we often don't talk about is how women play different roles at different times. You're a mother, you're
absolutely,
a wife, you're a first lady, you're an aunt, you're a daughter, you're an activist, you know, whatever. And sometimes we don't talk often enough about what the things happening around you, how they
impact how you cope with them.
Because I mean it would be an injustice not to try and understand at the tough times. I mean, yes, you're a separate entity from your husband, but there were tough times.
Definitely.
You know, and turmoil in the country. But what I'm trying to understand is, as a family, how you dealt with those challenges when they came at you, especially in your role as a wife.
I think for me it was easy because of the close proximity between myself and my husband.
Really?
Yes.
In the sense that
you understand why whatever that's happening is happening. You have a better understanding.
So there would be things that he would tell you.
Yes.
That
share with me,
would
of course.
Give you comfort.
And knowing that, okay, this is why this is happening. Mm-hmm. You know, you've got a better understanding as opposed to the ordinary person who's maybe just watching the news or reading the papers and it stops there and wouldn't have really the that knowledge, you know, that advantage of knowing the behind the scenes.
Would you and with your influence try and maybe speak about how to approach things, or would you just leave it at that? I've got the story, I've got the context that I need. I'm going to do what I need to do for my family, and I'm going to let my husband go about his duties the way he needs to. Therefore, I must not interfere or say anything.
Yeah, mine is just to provide support. But also, equally having said that, I think what maybe people may, I would say, perceive is that there must be a differentiation between the fact that I'm also a citizen and I have a right. I have a right to have my own opinions and a right to have a view on certain matters that affect me as well as a citizen, not as a spouse of the president. I think what then maybe may be difficult is to separate that, to say, I am a citizen, South African citizen, I voted, as a South African citizen, not as the spouse of the president.
But can you really separate the two at that time? Really? At that time, let us be honest. I'm not, if I see something that Umam Thobeka Madiba Zuma says on social media, I'm not thinking, oh, Thobeka Madiba Zuma, the citizen. I'm definitely thinking it's
Thobeka
Madiba Zuma, President Jacob Zuma's wife. At what stage am I supposed to say, oh, she's making a comment as a citizen, and oh, today she's making a comment as the wife? Is that fair?
But I've got my own identity, Ziyanda, and I've always wanted or championed to be seen as Thobeka, not as the wife or President Zuma's wife. That's what I've always championed for, to say, look at me as an individual. As much as I've got this link to me, patron, spouse of the president, whatever else, but can you look at me as an individual and as a person who has got her own identity? Because this life that found me, it found me with my own identity as Thobeka.
How tough is it supporting your husband? Because of who your husband is. We cannot run away from who your husband is. I mean, he is effectively one of the most spoken about politicians, arguably, since the dawn of democracy. You know, whether it's the good, the bad, or perceptions and what is real and what is not real. You did say that there's certain things that he will tell you, and then you think, okay, I'm going to close rank and protect him. But what has been the toughest part? For an example, the night when he told the country that I am resigning.
It's a decision that he made, and it's a decision that he made in the interest of the country, as he put it that day. And I think it's easy to support a person like him, because he's very focused and knows why he gave up his youth and why he spent 10 years in prison with no visitors and why he couldn't bury his mother. So I think supporting a person who is as big as he is, yes, I admit it's not easy, because he's big as a person, and the how he's viewed as well, and the role that he's played in politics. I think for me also it comes as I respect him as a leader, as my leader too. Okay. I respect the sacrifices that he made for us to be where we are, not alone with the other people that were in the struggle with him. And therefore, it makes it that easier for me to then provide that support that's necessary at that point in time. And when he wants to be left alone, you know, there are moments where you need to step back a bit and let him, you know, do his own thing, and you assess. And I think with me having been with him for 27 years, I think I know the type of a person he is, and I know what makes him tick, and I know when he needs his space, and I know when I need to be so close and provide that support as the spouse, as the mother of the kids, as his confidant sometimes, as his, yeah, soulmate, you name it. Yeah, I think when you've been with a person that long, you are able to assess and know that I need to be close, I need to step back, I need to give him space to think and hear himself think.
Was there ever a moment where you thought, I actually think that he might be making a mistake, and I must be the one to say stop, or to say, please listen to what the people are saying, or please, Baba, just approach this differently. Did that never happened?
I suppose, and as I said, knowing the things that I know, that some, of course, I can never share. I've never doubted him for a moment, never. And because he's always held the best interests of this country and has put the interests of the ordinary citizens, the poor, before anything.
What are some of the things that you'd want other women to take from you, as someone who's been in quite a lot of roles, actually, and in a role that not many people will ever be placed in?
I think it depends on the individuals, Leander, what it inspires them from what I've done, from my life lessons that they can draw and say, I would like to follow suit, I would like to. Some would write things that are really heartwarming and say, I just want to be half the woman you are when I grow up.
You are one of the first ladies out of all of the former prison. That's quite public on Instagram and you know, many incidents. Like just before your husband resigned, there was that post, Kutukusazo Shipukochi, and a whole...
Actually, the man...
Well, I don't know.
I don't know either.
But Leander, I mean, those are some of the things that gets said about you.
Yes.
And you did say you can't please everyone. But then how do you deal with that?
I think for me, how I deal with whatever gets thrown, you know, people will always have their views. And for me, a view and a perception falls under my external circle of influence. It's something that you cannot touch. It's something that you cannot influence or change. What is within my inner circle is what I can change. And for me, how I look at social media, it also depends, because it's changed the way it's being used. It's a very powerful tool to reach as many people as possible, and a platform of exchanging the information in an empowering way. And that's what it should be used for. But what Facebook said also when we were in America, I think about 2-3 years ago, they said it's also a platform that assists people to get to know those people that are in high offices, whether it's the president, whether it's the spouse of the president, that's where people can really get to connect with them. And I use it as such, to connect with people. But yes, I hear you when you say, or something negative, but even then, I have the right to have an opinion about the state of South Africa, where South Africa is and what's happening around me, because it, at the end of the day, it's the future of my kids. It affects the future of my kids, whether positively or negatively, it's another story. But whatever that's happening in our country, I think I also have a right to my opinion, to say this is what I think.
Are you the one who tweets for the former
not guilty. I know.
And that's your final answer.
Yeah, I've had people say, can somebody take the phone from him? But no, I'm not guilty.
So it's him the whole time. He tweets off that at Pris JG Zuma accounts.
I think so.
No, you know so.